Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Alright, I'm sorry. Okay, we need a little intro here.
Well, I was trying to pull up my agenda and everybody charged.
Little music, start our meeting back.
Yeah, now I don't know what to do.
That's right.
I can't see my agenda.
Oh.
Okay, is that it?
You okay?
Well, go ahead and do what you got to do. I'll be alright.
Okay. Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to our April 3rd morning meeting at Alamance County Commissioners. And to begin, I'd like to ask Commissioner Byrd if he'll do our invocation.
In recognition of the wide diversity of faiths that we have in our community, I would like to offer a moment of silence so that each of us can pray in our own way. And as we do, I'd like to ask each of you to remember why we are here, so that this body can lead and govern our county government as a body and not as individuals, in a manner that is best for all of our citizens. And let's remember victims of human trafficking and those that are suffering from other forms of oppression and enslavement, abuse, crime, and social injustices, and those that are homeless and hungry, especially our children, and those that are suffering from mental and physical illnesses and the challenges of aging. And let's remember our first responders, our law enforcement officers, and our uniformed armed services personnel who put themselves in harm's way every day to protect us. So with those things in mind, let's have a moment of silence. Thank you.
All right, let's do the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, this morning we have one person signed up for an agenda item, and that would be Mr. Tony Cox. And welcome, sir. Got the Carolina blue on today.
That's right. Thank you for that stuff you said, Mr. Byrd. The one thing is about this North Carolina building and fire code giving clear authority to code officials across the state. Looks like this is towards the fire codes, but as I go to different places and hear speakers, code enforcement has become a crisis in the state of North Carolina. Newspaper articles are coming out about the crises, mass incarcerations. This all goes back to this right here. Worked hard both collectively and individually to ensure the safety, health, and welfare of the citizens of this great state. North Carolina's failed. Conflict between code officials concerning authority and respective code officials and their conflicting interpretations of the technical codes. This stuff is huge. We're way behind. We're supposed to be at the front of this. Fire codes that cause the most conflict. Improper implementation of these chapters, resulting in serious injury and loss of precious lives. Both ways. Both ways. The Alamance County Board of Commissioners does hereby determine that the recommendations of the Fire Marshals Association relating to these issues are the most value and merit. The Board of Commissioners recommends and supports more clarity and code enforcement in this state. This is where I think it gets off from the fire stuff, because they are searching for clarity. state bar is. Other agencies down there. And suggest and recommends to the governor and general assembly of the state that the independent review of the code development enforcement process be undertaken. I think that this goes to that. I could be wrong, but if it don't, it needs to. We need a resolution down there. A lot of people are suffering as a result of this. On this next one right here about Department of Public Safety, all through here, we see about rights. It shouldn't have to be written. If I may, I have to have somebody at the breast center at 11 o'clock this morning. Mm-hmm. Can I do the public comments?
Sure, go ahead. We'll grant you three more minutes since you have a special appointment this morning.
You know, I got involved in this a long time ago because I seen bad things happen to my fellow Americans. And I've seen people come to these councils and commissions, and instead of helping us, they turned their back on us. But we're going to win, legally.
Tony, we will address that fire marshal issue when we get to that. Thank you. Any comments, folks? We're good? Okay. All right. Approval of the agenda.
I'll make the motion. We approve it.
All right.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Amy. Any discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Consent agenda. Is there anything there that anyone wants to pull? If not so, ask for a motion to approve.
So move.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Presentations today. We have first our EMS director, Ray. Welcome this morning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I've come before you today to present the Alamance County Accounts Receivable and Collections Policy. This policy is something new that we've not had in place before, and as you all are aware, it is the policy of the EMS department to bill for transports and other services performed to help reduce the general funds that are needed for the department to function. The purpose of the policy that we brought before you today is to formalize the procedures for how EMS bills and what methods are utilized to collect, and equally important, how uncollectible debts are dealt with. From what we've been able to gather, it's been over 10 years since any of the uncollectible EMS debt has been written off of the county's books. This policy dictates that all debt that is over 3 years old and has not had any activity be written off due to not having any legal ways to pursue the debt. In an effort to minimize this number in the future, the EMS department has taken several internal steps to ensure maximum collections. The primary effort has been to ensure that first pass collection rates are as high as possible. This has been accomplished by reviewing all charts in-house for billing accuracy prior to them being sent to our billing agency, as well as addressing any of the issues that the billing agency gives us as quickly as possible. As accounts age, the chances of collection minimize, so we want to take as much action as we can immediately to make sure we have a rapid approach to our billing process. In an effort to further minimize the amount that will need to be written off in the future, the EMS department currently uses some of the methods of collections that are listed on page 2 of the policy before you. The page simply lists all of the legal methods that we could utilize to collect debt, but given staffing constraints, we've decided in conjunction with the finance department to focus mainly on debt set off, which we've been doing for some time now, and we'll begin to utilize a collections agency July 1st. In addition, our billing agency also sends collection letters and performs telephone calls in an attempt to collect the debt. The adoption of this policy will ensure that all EMS accounts are dealt with in a consistent manner, And due to the degree of difficulty in calculating the current amount of receivables that need to be written off the books, we would like to return to you during the first quarter of next fiscal year to present you that definitive number. We're working with finance currently to produce that. Following that, we would like to return to you during the first quarter of each fiscal year to report to you any uncollectible debt that we feel should be written off of the books due to the constraints listed in the policy. I do want to reiterate that the adoption of this policy will not require a budget amendment for the EMS department. It does not affect the amount of revenue being collected this fiscal year or any other subsequent fiscal year. It simply addresses the outlying figures that are not collectible and therefore need to be written off to allow for clear accounting principles. So with that, I'd be happy to address any questions that you all may have.
I like the policy, and I think that it's good. And I know that billing for healthcare services can be very complex, so I understand the need to use an outside agency. You're dealing with multiple insurance companies and Medicare and Medicaid. But who is the agency that you're using?
We're currently with A&B.
And are you happy with their service?
Thus far, and we've been seeing a pretty consistent increase in revenue month to month. After we've been changed some stuff internally and with some stuff they've been doing. So
when I first came on the board my first year, there were some issues, and I know you weren't here, about with
the
customer
letters,
complaints.
The letters going out.
Yeah, letters going out. And I think we wanted to make sure that we had a local office where somebody could actually go to talk to somebody face-to-face.
Yes, sir.
Because the agency, I'm sure, is in a faraway place, right?
Yes, sir. It's in Paducah, Kentucky.
So do we still provide that?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, we welcome any of our patients to come in and see us in-house. And we've got a billing liaison set aside to kind of be the face of EMS billing. And, of course, I'm always happy to talk to anyone as well. But we do try to offer that local customer service in conjunction with the billing agency.
Do you have many people to take advantage of that?
We have a fair amount of folks that that don't want to send payments outside of the county, so they like to bring them in. So we happily accept those and process them and then send them on to where they need to be.
That's good.
And then Susan, you're okay from the finance department with this, and
yes,
good
sir.
Relationship between the billing agency and mm-hmm. getting the information that you need.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Where do those funds sit that are uncollected? Where have they been sitting?
Right now, they just sit on our general ledger as a receivable in our liability and asset codes. What we would be bringing back to you in the first quarter is that dollar amount of uncollectible receivable that we would like to just remove. It doesn't impact revenue or expenses
right.
collected. It's just to clean up our ledgers.
Yeah.
One thing we think would be helpful is if you guys, you remember when we had that issue where lots of letters were sent out to folks at the company perceived to owe, some of that we think came from this old debt that was
That's
sitting
bad.
On the books, so we'd
mm-hmm.
like to be able to
Confusion.
Wipe this off and avoid that in the future. So.
Maybe start fresh.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What you got?
Yeah, back before we went to that company, when did we go? Four years ago?
I think it was 15-16 may have been their first full
July of 2015 is when.
Oh, so that was a switch from who we were using prior?
Yes, we had grown unhappy with the company before A&B, and had actually right. notified them that we were going to put the service out to bid, but their company was purchased by, and A&B bought the company that we were dealing with. And so far, I think as Ray said, we've been pleased with the service they provided. Ray's folks have done a great job trying to make sure this process is consistent and effective. I think he's adopted some policies in the house that have helped make that happen.
Do you have a percentage of collections?
So we have seen an increase so far of, you know, it gets tricky looking at the numbers, but so far out of, for this current calendar year, they have billed out about $1.5 million and we've received $1.2 million. For a collection rate of about 78%. We were down somewhere around 60% during calendar year last year. But again, you know, it's money coming in this month for transports that we did, you know, four or five months ago. So it really gets...
One more. Back before we switched, and we were doing it in-house. We had about six people, is my understanding, that were doing this, right?
I'm not sure I could speak to how we did business when it was in-house. I know that it's probably been, Susan, do you have any idea how long we've been doing it with an outside company?
I want to say back to 2009 has been with an outside agency.
Okay. Well, my question is, it was my understanding that this was going to eliminate, through attrition or whatever, those people. And I'd like to know what the status of that is.
Well, I think we
not have, today, but when you get
right. Okay.
Sherry,
I don't have any questions.
Ms. Hook?
Thank you.
Okay. I guess we make a motion on this, sir.
Somebody. I'll make a motion to approve the policies as presented.
All right. Second. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Thank you, Ray.
All right. Thank you all very much.
Okay. All right. Mr. Johnny Payne, bring yourself up here, sir. We got to talk to you. Maybe you can clarify some of Tony's comments here.
What this, the four chapters in the building code and the fire code is a house bill they're trying to push through in Raleigh. Hillsborough Fire Marshal was supposed to be here today to speak on this. He had a call this morning. He couldn't come. They're trying to get the counties to support leaving these four chapters in the fire code, because now if they take them out of the fire code, if they strictly building code, if they go in 2 or 3 years down the road and the fire suppression system or the fire extinguisher are not checked, all life safety, we will not know them. So we're trying to leave it in the fire code where we go in every 1, 2, or 3 years, depending on the inspection schedule, we'll still be able to enforce this code to tell these folks you need to get your fire extinguishers up to date, your hood suppression systems, your sprinkler systems, and that's what it's about. They're trying to take it out to leave it on the building code. And once the building code goes in there 1 year, they don't go back and do these fire inspections.
So this is pretty much a maintenance program.
It's a maintenance program. This is just having your support, saying we support leaving these chapters in the fire code so we can do our job and ensure life safety down the road.
And this is mostly commercial and industrial.
Yes, sir.
Scenario, not residential.
No, we do not deal residential.
Yeah, so, okay. Any more questions on any comments?
So I'm not sure what Mr. Cox's point was.
I'm not either, totally. But I think he was talking about making sure that there is, not a conflict between building code and fire code.
We're just trying to stop it before it goes to vote.
Right.
In our fire code so we can enforce this every year.
And it makes sense because, he says, building inspectors there to give you a CO once you get a building completed. And after they leave, you had a fire extinguisher and you had that.
Yes,
so
sir.
It's really for public safety.
Yes, sir. That's life
exactly.
Safety, yes, sir.
Okay.
I'll make the motion. We accept it.
Okay. A second.
All right. Well, we will vote on this resolution then. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposition? No. All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank
you. Mr. Bruce Walker.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Here to ask for approval to grant authority to Brian Haygood, County Manager, to enter into a 5-year lease agreement for the hardware at $54,322.80 divided over 5 years of voiceover IP system, new phone system. That's just the one part of it. We thought, in talking to Randy and talking to Susan and Brian, we thought we'd put the whole project out there for you to see. This was a promise to replace our aging system about 4 years ago before I got on here. When I went around and talked to the different department heads, this was an emergency situation after getting the networking stuff done, making sure our house was in order. This is the next big project that we had. Many folks are on their last legs and don't have any support. So we talked to different folks, and because of the investment you guys put into our current system, we can do it on-premise rather than the cloud, which saves us a lot of money. This system, again, the hardware part is the part we're asking for, but we're not asking for any additional funds to handle this. This is allocated through money that was already allocated. Some folks held it over because they were promised this. Different departments are paying for their actual phones. And again, when we switch from the everyday charges we get from AT&T to this, that will help pay for this as well. So with that, Is there any questions on this project?
So this eliminates the need to have what they call a switch?
Well, it takes away the old legacy phones that are on the traditional system, and now we have it on our own servers here.
So it's on servers now instead of the old fashioned phones.
Now, we have to keep, there's a handful we'll have to keep for alarm systems and stuff like that, but the vast, I mean, all the employees will have that. It's a huge enhancement because, gosh, just with the tax department recently, you know, when they had all the flood of phone calls in, we had only one system that kind of went around. This will give a lot more options to make sure we have better service. The amount of tools and things that allow us to answer the phone more quickly, make sure it's a human being are there. It's just, the technology's been around for almost 20 years, and again, it's been something that people have been clamoring for a long time.
Does this place more burden on our internet capabilities?
Voice doesn't take that much space, and we've already been truth checked on our system to make sure that we could handle it. And again, because of the investment of what you guys have put into the system, we're up to date and can plenty handle it. So.
And the departments, you're saying, are using their funds to help put phones in the department?
Most of the larger departments have the funding. Some of the smaller ones, the funding fell behind, and we're going to just kind of absorb that and kind of help them. It was a hodgepodge because some folks held on to their monies and some people couldn't.
And this was out of what, performance-based management funds?
It was just left over from the project, just held over.
From the total project.
Okay. Yeah.
I have a little question. I hope this isn't a dumb question from me, but what if the internet goes down? What if there's something happens? Are emergency systems, the sheriff's department, EMS, the other emergency providers, are they still going to be able to talk to each other if the internet's down?
Absolutely.
And people will be able to communicate with them?
Absolutely.
If the internet's down.
It has systems that will automatically go to cell phones, or keeping some of the phones, we're going to have to keep some of those phones for those abilities. And there's some appliances that transfer from our system out into the older legacy system. You can't completely get rid of it, but I mean, we're talking a handful.
And I guess that's with CECOM too.
Absolutely. I mean, that's the priority, of course.
Other questions? All right, I'll entertain a motion to grant this authority for us to move forward with this.
I'll second it.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, very good. Thank you, Bruce. Department of Social Services. Welcome, Susan.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So we've come before you this morning as a part of the performance management policy. When we were working on our budget this year, we didn't really know what our performance management from last year was going to be. But once we had the audit and we had that number, we were able to, our proposal is to move 5 new cars out of our new budget for next year and pay for it with performance management now. So this is for 5 new cars. We are looking at the state contract, maybe the Equinox level, because we're getting more and more sibling groups of children coming into foster care, and we really need the ability to put 3 car seats in the back seat. We're still driving, bless you, Sheriff, some of our 1995 Crown Vicks.
You get 4 in the back of those guys.
Well, yeah, you're right. There's just not enough seat belts, I'm afraid. This request also includes some more opportunities to kind of renovate and refurbish some of the 20-year-old furbishings at DSS. You know, when the hospital left, we refurbished in 1995. So this will put some flooring down, take up some carpet that hasn't been replaced. And the reason for that is we don't have funds to do regular cleaning, and so the carpet just really gets, so we're looking at the laminate flooring, which seems to work better. And then we're updating some cubicles to be able to put more folks in the same amount of space. So these are all performance management funds. I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have. Pretty much wipes out our performance
so
management
you're done
fund.
For the year. We won't see you back on that anymore.
We'll have a little bit left, but not much.
Okay. Any questions, guys? Lady? No. All right. I'll take a motion.
I'll make the motion.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay. we are moving into our audit contract, and I guess you're going to speak to that?
Yes, sir. On the agenda this morning, Commissioners, is a request to approve our fiscal year 16-17 audit contract with Martin Starnes and Associates. This will be the second year of the contract that we entered into with them last year. This has to be done every year for LGC approval.
Have they gone up on this price?
It's a slight increase of $1,750, but that price should maintain through fiscal year 18. And that was included in their bid process.
Right, and we did not bid that out at all this year to any
other. That's correct. When the bid came back at the last time, we were going for a three-year time period. Mm-hmm. So after fiscal year 18, we would be able to put that out to bid again.
18, okay.
In this contract, is the local government commission standard contract, is their language, right?
Correct.
All right. I will make a motion that we move forward with this.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Sorry.
That's all right.
Thank you.
All right. Very good. Alamance County Mental Health Maintenance of Effort Funding. Okay.
Well, good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
I'm here this morning to update you on how we plan to change how we allocate our mental health maintenance of effort funds. The county began maintenance of effort funding in 2001, and we originally were paying Alamance Caswell LME. These funds are approximately equal to what the county was spending on mental health services when we were divested of those services, approximately $1.2 million. Since 2011, we have allocated these funds to Cardinal Innovations. Cardinal is the mental health service provider for Alamance County and is responsible for providing mental health core services here. And Cardinal Innovations is encouraging the counties in their service area to determine local priorities for these MOE funds and to select the areas that need these fundings most, giving the counties more local control over the money. And some of our local priorities for Alamance County for mental health services include crisis service and diversion from the jail, which is part of our Stepping Up initiative. So Cardinal Innovations is our mental health service provider. That does not change. They remain responsible for ensuring that mental health services are provided to the county. Cardinal will be partnering with us to help us address our local priorities and to transition this funding from them directly to the providers. So what we're talking about doing is for next fiscal year, 17-18, Alamance County would no longer give this $1.2 million to Cardinal Innovations. We would contract directly with the service providers that Cardinal has been contracting with. All the folks that are currently contracting with Cardinal would be asked to submit proposals directly to Alamance County, and these proposals would include details of the services that they're proposing to provide in 17-18 and how much that would cost. And then what we'd like to do is a group of Alamance County staff, I would suggest this would include DSS, Health, County Manager's Office, and the Sheriff's Office, since they provide a tremendous amount of mental health service in Alamance County. These folks will get together and we will review the proposals from these service providers, and then we will make contract recommendations back to the board. So I would be coming back to you with a list of contractors that want to provide mental health service to Alamance County with these local MOE funds, and I'd give them all to you. You could review them and then vote to award those funds as you wish. I would suggest that as we review these funds, we may want to have one commissioner also involved with that review. The contracts would need to be back to the board before July 1st, because most of these folks' funding is starting 17-18 year, just as ours is. So I'd be coming back to you at one of our upcoming meetings with a list of these contracts. So I'm not requiring any action now. Your action would be, I'm just giving you an update, this is the way we're moving. Your action would come before July 1 when you would review and approve the contracts. We do have our Cardinal Innovations representative here, Mr. Rick Bruton. And I'd like to ask if Rick could come up and speak a little bit about what I'm talking about. So thanks for being here, Rick.
Thank you, Brian. So I'm Rick Bruton. I'm a senior community executive with Cardinal Innovations Healthcare. And as Brian said, this is really about giving you guys a little more control for your local funds. It's about being a true community partner and being good stewards of your money, honestly. So traditionally, the money flowed through us for your county funds, and then we divvied out and put it back out. There's a clear vision here, thanks to leadership on the Stepping Up initiative, of how they would like to spend this money. So it just makes sense to give you guys a little more control. Any questions? Well, I just want to clarify, like, this is just the local funds. Cardinal Innovations Healthcare is still a managed care organization for Medicaid and state-funded mental health, developmental disability, and substance use disorders.
What kind of changes legally is it going to be? Any?
No.
Okay.
I'd like just to add, a few months ago, Susan Osborne and Craig Honeycutt and myself, and who else was on that trip?
Tim Britt.
Went to visit the CEO of Cardinal Innovations, Richard Topping is his name, and we met at the Cardinal's Chapel Hill offices. And really, we were kind of requested by the CEO of Cardinal to take the county money back and do your whatever you want to do with that money. And my understanding is that the maintenance of effort funds is statutorily required, so that back in the old days when we had our own mental health center, the county funded it to that approximately that level. And when everything switched to the LME and then the MCO LMEs, we were required to continue that same level of funding, which went to Cardinal. And so now what we're wanting to do is bring that money back. Most of the money, that $1.2 million that we've been given to Cardinal, has been, like, about $900,000 of that has been going to RHA for the Crisis Center. I think, is that about right?
Correct.
A little bit went to Alamance Regional Medical Center to fund some nurses in the emergency department to handle mental health. And five or six other smaller pots of money went different places. But this will give us more control. And
yes, sir. And our intent will be to contact each one of these agencies that have been receiving MOE funds from Cardinal. We'll contact each one of them to make sure they have an opportunity to also apply again. So they'll give us a proposal, tell us what their service would be. We'll review that proposal and then bring you a list of contracts on how we would divvy out the MOE funds.
Any other questions?
There's no action required. We just wanted to let you know this is the direction we're moving in conjunction with Cardinal. We've appreciated all the help Rick has been and Cardinal Innovations have been also.
I mean, I personally like this idea of bringing money back to the county to have some latitude of control and to work on things like the Stepping Up initiative, which I think is a great program.
Yeah, when I met with Ryan, you know, it's your money. What do you want to do with it? I'll help you. I'll get you data. I'll get you whatever you need to help make informed decisions, but flowing through us.
And I think the state had cut out some grant money possibly coming back. So I think it's a good idea. We'll move.
Great. On. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Rick.
Okay. Resolution of the lottery funds. Who played the lot?
Commissioners, good morning again. What this resolution is asking is just support in giving this to our local legislative delegation and to the North Carolina General Assembly. Since the fiscal year 2009-10, we have been drastically reduced in our funding from 2.8 of lottery money down to an estimated of 1.5 for the fiscal year 16-17. So this is just to support. Last year, the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners had this as one of their top priorities. It's not listed in 16-17, so this just brings that awareness back to our local delegation.
Okay. Well, I'd also like to recognize we have two of our school board members here, Pam Thompson and Steve Van Pelt, this morning, and maybe y'all can do a resolution also if you haven't already. I think what's happened is the lottery's intentions didn't end up being what it was sold to be.
Yeah, that's true.
What were the percentages originally that were supposed to go for education versus what they are today?
If I'm not mistaken, Mr. Sutton, it was 40% was to be given to the schools for education. And whereas when we had another resolution a couple of years ago, it was down to 20.8%.
Unbelievable.
And what the legislature did was to cap that at $100 million for 100 counties.
Yeah, part of this resolution's third line on it, the distribution to Alamance County budgeted from North Carolina Education Lottery in year 2009 and 10 has been drastically reduced from $2.8 million at the previous statutory funding rate of 40% to $1.5 million for the year 2016-17.
Was the cap after the 40%?
Yes.
Quote? So yeah. We went against what they told the state.
Yes, that's correct. That's what it was sold.
Well, your state legislators need to be held accountable.
Yes.
And both parties are involved in it.
Yep.
Absolutely.
All right, so if it's okay, do we need a vote on that? I don't. Okay.
Yeah. I'll make the motion.
Thank you, Bill.
I second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, very good. Okay. Brian, you're back to the podium, sir.
Certainly. I have a request, commissioners, that you would approve us taking $105,000 from appropriated fund balance to fund the purchase of an installation of a new chiller for the county office building. The current chiller serving this building and civil court, part of civil court, is in need of repair. Through some PM work, we discovered that the chiller, the condenser coil needs to be replaced and needs to have new refrigerant put in it. This will cost approximately $25,000. The repair will cost about $25,000. The unit itself is 21 years old. These units have about a 20-year life expectancy. Our estimate for a new chiller is $94,000. We're asking for $105,000 total with some contingency in the event we run into some other problems while we're putting it in or having it installed. That contingency is $11,000. We will bid out the installation of the chiller. We have not done that yet. We're asking that you allocate the money if you would consider doing that. Then we will bid it out, and if we come in under the $105,000, anything that we do not spend will be returned to appropriated fund balance. I have Buddy Weitzel's here. If you have any detailed questions about the chiller, I would defer to Buddy. He's the head of our maintenance and facilities department. But it just we are asking to take it from appropriated fund balance, but it seemed like a wise request in that it's $25,000 to repair this chiller that is beyond its projected life expectancy. It would allow us to plan the replacement as opposed to if it went out in the middle of summer, we would expect
shut down
a week or 2 weeks to get one in, and that would be disastrous. So I'll be happy to try to answer any questions, and I'm sure Buddy would be too, if you have any. So
what kind of warranties would you have for this one?
There he is, Buddy.
Warranties.
The warranty on the new equipment,
on
I guess.
Equipment,
yes, sir.
Usually 1 year on parts and labor, and the compressors are usually 5 years on the warranty. And what? This chiller here uses the R22, which is no longer made, and it's $900 a jug for that. And once the stockpile is gone, we'll have no more refrigerant for it. So eventually it's going to have to be replaced anyway, because you won't be able to repair it.
I got a question, buddy. On the energy savings, I'm assuming your energy saving will be considerable.
The new chiller is a lot more energy efficient, plus it's a lot quieter, too. Right. You'll have a lot less noise coming off the roof from the new chiller.
Any other questions?
What's the condition of the jail's chillers?
One of them is fairly new. We just rebuilt the old chiller to get it back online, so they got a backup chiller. So they got two chillers to operate at the jail right now. The one at the criminal courts building is reached its life expectancy. It's time to replace it too. So that's another like $125,000 to replace it. And
that project is in our 5-year capital improvement plan. And the replacement of the old chiller at the jail was a very recent capital project. I don't know if it was this year or last year, but that gives the jail a backup in the event one goes out. You know, we're still able to keep the cool conditions inside. So.
How about the human services?
We replaced that one when we did the renovation. It's like 5 years old, but we've already had to do some repair on the coils on it. The new equipment, they just use cheaper products in building coils and stuff. It's thinner metal, and we've already had some leaks on that where we've had to patch on the coils on it.
But you can get the refrigerant
You can get the refrigerant for it.
I'll make the motion
to upgrade.
Accept upgrade, yeah.
Okay. I'll second it.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bob. Any more discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. You're in against? Thank you, sir. And you just stay right there.
All
right.
And I'm asking also this morning that the board approve
relocating the Monday, April 17th Commissioners Meeting from here at the County Office Building to the historic courthouse. That evening, we'll be having budget presentations from Alamance Borough School System, Alamance Community College, and then a number of internal departments, I think Sheriff's Office, Health, and DSS, and then I'll be going over an overview of the rest of county government's requests. So thought it'd be wise to relocate that evening up to historic courthouse. So,
I think that's a good idea. Yeah. I'll make that motion.
All right. Bob, second it. Thank you, Bob.
One point on that, though. I assume it's going to be balcony use as well.
Yes.
Yeah. Who cleans out the balcony? I don't know who's been up there last.
We'll make sure we check it.
Yeah, somebody needs to look at it.
It's bad shape. Yeah. All right. We got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Aye, too. Yeah.
Very good.
A little late this morning.
That's all right. Okay. Debbie Hatfield, Emergency Management.
Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. As you see on there, we're requesting a budget amendment for $10,000. This is a hazardous material emergency planning grant. We have applied and got a grant for $10,000. This money will be used to conduct an interstate functional exercise with several departments. As y'all know, we have a lot of issues on the interstate. We've actually had some tabletops. We've written an interstate annex policy. And so this is what we'd like to use this money for. It's be 100% reimbursed.
Okay. Any questions? You got off easy, didn't you? I'll make a motion that we do this.
Thank you.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, very good. Sheriff, I think you're up. PM program.
I'm appearing before the board this morning to ask to be able to use some of our performance-based budgeting money. We've been invited back to the National Law Enforcement Memorial this year, our honor guard. For all the names of the officers that have been killed this year, it's being put on the wall. And I'm asking that we be able to use $23,000. We rent a bus, pay for our people's trip up there, and participate in the National Law Enforcement Officers Memorial Week.
Where's the wall at? That's a good idea, Sheriff.
Do what, sir?
Where's the wall at up there?
Right. I can't think of the name of the street, but it's right there.
Judiciary Square.
Yeah, Judiciary. Okay. That's what I was trying to think.
Y'all been, how many years you've been up there? Several
we,
years?
We've been up our last two years ago.
I remember the Massey gentleman.
And did that. I'll be honest with you, our people were the best up there.
Well, of course.
And they invited us back. And we'd like to be able to do that. I am going to take him with us, hopefully, if he will go, to let him see. If you've never been there, oh, what a touching site that is.
Sure. And unfortunately, we had a lot of names to add to that. A
lot of names to in North Carolina. Right. You know, they had on the wall and all over the nation. Yeah. This will probably be the biggest years for names going on the wall.
That's
I remember the first time we were up there, there were 22 busloads of spouses and their children whose fathers and mothers would be added to the wall. Wow. And that's touching.
How many names are on it now?
Wow.
I think it's 30,000.
Unreal, yeah.
Wow.
It's unreal.
Yeah. It's a bunch.
Yeah. Unreal.
We
also are asking for 10,000 performance-based budgeting to be used. We want to run three summer camps for youth this summer. We call it Dare Camp. Summer camps, but we want to have at-risk youth and everything with our people working with these kids, and we're asking for $10,000 also to be transferred from performance-based budgeting.
Okay.
And then we're starting a Alamance County Explorers program for youth to come into our office and do the Explorer program, which is through the scouting. And I'm asking for $20,000 there of performance-based money to be transferred for a total of $63,000.
The Explorer program, hasn't the city of Burlington, don't they do something similar to that, the police academy in the summer? I've been to their banquets, and that the kids get so much out of that.
Well, I'm telling you, we have got to do something for our kids.
Well, and children need to know how to react when they are faced with law enforcement and what to do and what not to do. I mean, so you're critical.
You're absolutely right, but hopefully, too, we will benefit from this because as they reach age 21, they may want to go in law enforcement.
There you go.
And we won't have such a hard time recruiting decent people for the agency.
I think it's great to give them that option. Okay.
Sheriff, I'll make a motion. I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't want to interrupt. If you want to make your motion,
go ahead.
Okay. Sheriff, can you explain or help me understand why it's $23,000 to go to D.C.? For that trip.
Have you ever been in a motel in D.C.?
Staying at the Trump flat.
I can answer that.
$4,000, I think, to rent the bus, and then we're taking right at about 30 of our people, and then we're going to also, and they'll hopefully, some of the local agencies wanting to send some people, will recoup that money. And may not
put it back into that fund.
That's a very conservative estimate, too, because until we knew that we could go, how many folks we will be standing post, that would change our number. So we went for a full bus load. It will be less than that.
So you're carrying your honor guard, basically.
Yes, sir. We're hoping our honor guard is sharp as they come. But some of the other agents has talked about wanting to do a joint-type honor guard, and Washington has agreed to allow that. But if they don't look sharp and they ain't gonna stand with my paper.
But you know, I'm proud of our Sheriff's Department. I know y'all do a good job, and I'd be glad to be represented by you all in D.C. I just have to say, when my family went to D.C. on spring break a few years ago, we stayed in a campground and had to walk to the campground facilities and stuff. So when we went to D.C., we did not stay in a hotel. Just to clarify that point. And we rode the train into town, so... Gailies do know the value of a dollar, but I appreciate those assurances by other jurisdictions hopefully kicking in. $23,000 is a lot
now
of money.
Now, if you've got enough campers, we'll take campers.
We weren't in a camper either. I don't think I'll be doing that again. I can't.
Just campers are rocking, don't come a knocking.
Tim has a comment, I think, that he'd like to share.
2,267 as of last year. They're adding 252 this year.
Well,
okay. All right, Bill.
I'll make the motion. We accept that.
All right. I'll second it. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, sir.
Very
much.
Good. Thanks. Okay. Susan, I guess.
Yes, sir.
You're next.
Before you this morning, Commissioners, is just to correct a clerical error. We had a budget amendment that was presented twice to the Board of Commissioners, and by general statute, when it's increased, it has to be done by the commissioners, and when we decrease, it has to be done by the commissioners. So this will be just reversing one of those postings.
Okay.
You need a motion?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
All right. Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
May I ask a question on this? I apologize. What was the dollar amount of that? Wasn't it over $1 million?
It was 1.5.
All right. Now, is that going to change any lines with our...
It does not.
In-house, general fund or anything like that?
No, sir. It does not. We had already budgeted for that and taken that into account. We've done the transfer once. This is just to clean up our accounts because it had been approved twice. We couldn't just go in and say, oh, we didn't need that one, because you, as a commissioner board, had approved for that. So we have to have that approval again to correct our records.
Yeah, it's 1.518,106 is that amount, and just a line transfer in the county books, basically.
Correct.
All right, we got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right, next we have an amendment for the health department. And we have Stacy here to make that today.
Good morning. Before you have a budget amendment for food and lodging in our environmental health section in the amount of $42,749. And this allocation is basically for our food and lodging program, that we get allocations at the beginning of a fiscal year, but when we get to a point where we have 100% compliance, if you look in the agreement addenda that's there, per the general statute, for those counties that reach 100% compliance in their food and lodging inspections, they receive additional funds, and we are one of those counties. So that's what the funds are in front of you, and we plan to use the funds to purchase equipment that we're using in environmental health, printers, and some small tools like meters and thermometers that are needed for food and lodging inspections, and then also two vehicles to replace our aging fleet. We have about 17 vehicles that are about 12 to 15 years old that we are also very grateful to the sheriff, but also ready to get rid of some things.
Sheriff, they appreciate it, but they just tired of your vehicles. Can you explain a little bit more about what compliance and the 100% number really saying?
So in our county, we have several food establishments, and it's the requirement for the health department and the environmental health as agents of the state to go in and actually inspect those food and lodging establishments. Depending on the complexity of the food that they're actually making, they're inspected different times. Some get inspected 4 times a year, some just 2 times a year, depending on what they're doing. And luckily, our folks have a really great system that they get in there and do 100% of our food and lodging inspections every year, so that to ensure that you all are going into places that are up to standard, using sanitation and hygiene the way that they're supposed to, and that the establishment has been inspected by your food and lodging staff.
How do you guys, I noticed there are a number of the little stands on the side of the road now. I did notice one had a numeric number over on Church Street, but are you checking those, or?
So the food stands are new, fairly new, and if you're seeing sort of the sanitation piece of it, then folks have gone in. They're required to do permitting and those types of things. I can find out exactly how many we have for you. I don't have that
I've
number
today.
I've
noticed there seems to be a lot more popped up over the last year.
They're very popular,
year.
Particularly in urban areas as well. Yeah. So we're seeing that. I can find out from environmental health how many we have for you.
And I got one more question.
Okay.
I had a guy ask me the other day, he said, Zika virus, where does that come from?
Okay.
Comes from water and things, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you turn the corner of Graham, Hopedale, and Church Street, mm-hmm. there's a number of tires over there. Do we not have any ordinances to public safety to take care of that issue?
So that issue came up, I believe, last year with the city of Burlington, and that they were actually looking at what can they do.
I mean, it's a health concern because the Zika virus, I think, is for mosquitoes.
And it's been summertime.
Yes,
and
that's
mosquitoes.
Right.
Mosquitoes.
Yeah.
Certain type.
And what latitude maybe do we have as a board to ask for enforcement on city codes, I guess, would be the ones that would.
Well, too, just gets hit all the time on the radio show about that. When he comes on and he just basically says, you know, not much they can do.
Well,
short
if it's a health issue,
yeah, I agree.
I think, you know, if I have a big hole in the back of my yard and mm-hmm. mosquitoes are breeding, I think.
I'm just telling you what he says.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah,
I don't listen in to that very
often. We can reach out to the city manager and see if they've got anything in the works about that property, and then let you know. And also, coordinate with Stacy and the health department if that's appropriate.
I was going to say, if you'd like for us to explore it with the Board of Health, we can absolutely do that through the Board of Health and even their jurisdiction potentially at that point.
I mean, those are things I think we as a local board should look at that are health concerns for the whole community.
I'll be glad to take that back.
Board of Health has jurisdiction in all the municipalities.
That's correct. So we can look at what potential there is.
I didn't mean to get off topic here, but
and just know as we approach warmer weather, that if folks are asking about vector control, to please reach out to Environmental Health, and we're happy to help folks. We've got our tip and toss campaign that's out there. We're looking at some other campaigns to do this summer. But if you're not aware, there was in our state many years ago vector control monies, and there still are in small amounts, but those are one of the funds that got cut a few years ago, so we're trying very hard to have our legislators understand how important it is to retain some of that funding for purposes like this.
What is vector control?
So a vector is, in our world, would be the mosquitoes that actually carry disease. So the controlling of those insects that carry that, the vector in which the disease is harbored.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Any other questions on that?
Good.
Okay. I will ask for a motion to approve this amendment.
So move.
Thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank
very
you.
Good. Okay. Brian, you have a lot on the thing today, don't you?
Busy
this being county manager has a lot. Nice picture of you in the paper this morning.
Nice article.
Should have been at the top of the paper, though.
Oh, Isaac. Heading below the fold.
I would like to take this opportunity to remind the commissioners that today at 12 noon at the historic courthouse, we have the Ring Out Against Child Abuse event. It'll be to increase awareness of child abuse and neglect. So that's today, 12 noon. There'll be some speakers and all kind of activities going on at the historic courthouse. So hope to see you there. And at this time, I'd also like to turn this back over to Stacy and Public Health. I believe they have a proclamation that we were not able to get on the agenda, but they're wanting to bring before you regarding Public Health Month.
Good time to talk about tires and
right. We can continue that discussion if you'd like. I'm presenting today to you a proclamation, and I just have a few copies for you. And I apologize that we did not get this on the agenda, but very thankful to Brian and Tori for their efforts to allow me to present this to you today. So April is Public Health Month. And so thank you for your timely discussion about Zika. I have other copies if you
want. Let me have one, if you don't mind, ma'am.
As it's a great way to bring awareness to what public health does in your communities. And so today I'm presenting to you a proclamation to acknowledge that April is Public Health Month. And if you would like, I can read it for you.
I think you should read it so everybody can hear it.
Sure, that's good.
Hit the highlight. So whereas we hereby recognize and acknowledge 79 years of public health service here in Alamance County, as well as the vast contributions of these services to the quality of life in our communities. And whereas public health plays a crucial role in the foundation of good health and quality of life lived by working to immunize people against disease, by working to control environmental health hazards and infectious disease, by improving the health of mothers and children, and promoting healthy behaviors in areas of tobacco use, physical activity, and nutrition. And whereas the Alamance County Health Department is an active partner in the county's emergency response to natural and man-made disasters and is a critical component in the response to widespread disease outbreaks in our community, in which the local health providers and partners dedicated more than 1,934 hours to public health preparedness and response planning in the last year. And whereas public health plays a critical role in eliminating health inequities and preventing chronic disease and injuries, resulting in improved productivity and decreased health care costs for all Alamance County residents. And whereas a continued focus on prevention in Alamance County has resulted in an increase in life expectancy from 58 years to 77.4 years since 1938, which is the year the health department was founded, and a more than 50% decrease in teen pregnancy rates and infant mortality rates in the last decade, and a total of 7,495 dental health visits and 4,048 environmental health inspections, evaluations, and specimens collected in 2016. And whereas public health strives to protect everyone who lives, works, and visits Alamance County from health threats and disasters through the successful use of new and existing initiatives and collaborative partnerships with a multitude of agencies in the community to find solutions to health care, to health issues. And therefore, now you, the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, do hereby proclaim April 2017 Public Health Month in Alamance County and urge our citizens to recognize that public health is working to ensure that all residents of Alamance County are healthy.
Thank you.
I'll take a motion to accept.
I'd like to make that motion.
Thank you, Bob.
I'll second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor of accepting this proclamation?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Could I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
Hepatitis C seems to be unbelievable in our country. What's the status of it in this county? Because it actually wasn't even around that much 20 years ago, 25 years ago.
So thank you for bringing that, because that's a really great opportunity for me to talk a little bit about the intersection of opioid use and the epidemic that we're seeing with opioids, not only in our state, but nationally, and the intersection of that with infectious disease. So hepatitis rates are increasing, both statewide and nationally. I don't have the figure for our county off the top of my head. But folks are proposing that a lot of that has to do with our also increased opioid use that we're seeing, and that typically that goes hand in hand with IV drug use, and that with dirty needle kind of exchange that you have exchange of infectious disease. So there are increased rates of it. I do not know off the top of my head what it is for Alamance County, but I'll be glad to find out for you.
About it, yeah. Because you hear, everywhere you go, you hear people talking about it.
Well, I do. Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
No. Nope. Thank you very
much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Public comments. Tony's already made him. I wish him well with his girlfriend, I guess that is. He's taken to the hospital. Commissioner, comments?
Yeah, I got two quick.
Okay.
Talk about the wall. I don't know, this might seem irrelevant to some people, but you know, 4 or 5 years ago, and I think it would be linked to, well, let me just, Caleb and I went down to, we were at Fort Bragg, he was 10 years old, and we go walking up the sidewalk at JSOC, and there's a Fort, well, no, there's a Storm Drive, and there's a big wall of 1,400 some names of soldiers, Special Forces soldiers that had been killed. And just out of the mouth of a 10-year-old, he looked at the wall and he said, there's room for more. And I said, yeah, I'm afraid there's going to be more put up there. And he said, just out of the mouth of a 10-year-old, he said, if people would just do right, you wouldn't have to put no more names up there. I said, man, you hit that one. Same way with the wall you're going to sit there. And bring back some pictures.
Yeah,
I'd love to see that.
I think you did the last time you brought a presentation of it.
Sheriff's office.
Now, last week I got, who did I talk to on this? I don't remember. Susan Roberts on this. This is a report that I used to look at it religiously, and then being out for 2 years, I haven't seen the latest one. Well, the last 2 years worth, and it was mentioned at a school board meeting, rating in this, and I'm not going to debate the ratings right now, I will, but in the future, but bottom line is this public school forum report is a report put out every year by a nonpartisan group, at least I think they are. If John Locke Foundation put it out, it'd be something else, but I'd still trust it, but this group is about as, I think, fair and open as they can be, and if you look at it, there are several charts to look at. You know, it shows ability, it shows actual effort, shows relative effort of all the school systems in the state. Shows charts on ADM, it shows charts on money, and it's just a wonderful piece of information. Not to give you any pros and cons about any of the ratings right now, but I hope everybody keeps it and refers to it. We used to buy the copies. Now online, I think you can get it free, and which is amazing. And used to cost about $8 a piece, but I think how'd you get it to come out? That's the way it always looks in color and everything. Mm-hmm. How'd you do that?
She's anyway, magic on that computer, isn't she? Yeah.
Looks good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Where did you get that? That's probably a good thing for to put in as something we could look at on a regular basis.
It actually came from the Public School Forum's website. They have
DPI.
It's a separate website from DPI. Okay. I can send you the link.
Okay, Commissioner.
It's a nonpartisan, nonprofit right. Agency.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, if you can send us that link,
I'll send you that link.
And that way we can look at it as we move forward.
And it also has prior year reports on there as well. Mm-hmm.
Actually, I called their research director and left a message asking her if she could sort all of her data just using Alamance. I hadn't heard back from her yet.
Well, it's listed.
Yeah, it's listed.
So I would have
there,
to go through and click year by year and make my own little chart.
Yeah.
So I intend to do that, though.
I thank you, Mr. Sutton, for getting this. I analyze it a little bit more myself because that last column, I'm having a little
difficulty in synthesizing what it really means, and so I'm going to push.
74th rating? You're talking about the 74th rating?
No, I'm talking about the 41st one, I think, and the very last column, the fifth column.
Was it relative effort?
The relative effort.
Yeah. I tell you, it's tough to understand it. And again, I'm not going to say plus or minus, but I am going to say this. I thought you were talking about 74. I called down and talked to the director myself, and he called me back. He's from Fayetteville, and we had a long talk. But long story short, he said he'd have to have the guy that's very well-versed on that particular ranking. It's where you get low-wealth money. And he said, in essence, for your county to be – I said, why is there such a disparity between where we are with actual, relative, and ability? And that's those are three key issues there. Ability, relative effort, and effort, actual effort. I said, why is there such a disparity between the 74th rating and those ratings? And he said, in essence, you'd have to be a poor county to have your to not be there. And he said, you obviously, he said, you get some low wealth money, but you don't get much, $4 million. And we don't get any in another category. He said, you'd actually have to be just poor to have that rating be higher. That's what he told me. I don't know. But anyway, it's fun to watch it, look at it. I go in and take ADM of peer systems. In other words, to me, our peer groups are the school systems that have relatively the same number of students we have, give or take 1,000 or 2,000 students. Somebody told me on the phone the other day, there's 10. You know, last time I looked at it, it was 14 inclusive with us. And then I get in and look at test scores of people below us, ADM per pupil versus those that are higher. And it's fun to look at it. I mean, it's a telling story, too. We'll talk about that more later, I hope.
Yeah, that's good. Our next meeting, most likely.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if I'll bring it up then.
Well, we have some budget presentations.
Trust me, I'll have it handed.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Any other comments?
Will those be public hearings? It won't be a public hearing.
Yeah, it will. I think it will, won't it?
The 17th will just be presentations.
Right, presentations.
That's right. Then May 1st will be outside agency presentations. May 15th will be county manager's recommended. And then the 5th will be the public hearing.
June the 5th.
June 5th.
Hopefully, yes.
Now, that's a morning meeting. Are we going to move that to an evening?
Yes, when we get closer to the dates, I think we have to move a couple of them. We have to switch the June 5th and the June 19th meetings, and then we would be also relocating the June 5th meeting to the historic courthouse. That would be my suggestion.
Preliminary for folks that are interested.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
So the 17th will just be presentations.
I'd like to make a couple of comments. Mm-hmm. This past week, Tim and myself, and I guess we were the only two commissioners there, went on a tour of Southern Alamance High School, which I thought was very interesting, and it helps to inform myself, and I expect anybody who attends, just about some of the legitimate needs that we have in our school system. And I know that this is going to be talked about in our next meeting with when the superintendent presents the school system's budget. And I know there's going to be pressures on this body to increase funding for the school system. And I think about the future funding needs that our facilities have. And I just like to kind of relate the importance of education on the discussion about law enforcement and some of the other safety net services that we as a county spend a lot of money on. And just to remind everybody that so much could be different over maybe a longer period of time than just a few years, but if we truly have a national model of a public education system, which is in the vision that was created by the community for ADSS, if we truly have that national model, and it's a national model because we have the best teachers, we're able to recruit and retain the very best teachers, and that's where the rubber hits the road when it comes to educating our kids. But really good principals to manage those teachers and hire the great teachers and to provide the support that they need. And if kids are really getting their education in facilities that are conducive to learning, and the curriculum is good, and there's just so many great things going on with the Alamance Burlington school system, with special programming, and all this is part of their strategic plan, making sure our teachers are paid competitively so we can attract and retain the best. Facilities is part of the strategic plan. Special programming is part of the strategic plan. And you look at the global initiatives that are going on in the school system and in the arts and the virtual learning opportunities that our kids have, the splash programs at various elementary schools, and it's just terrific. The International Baccalaureate program, which is coming, it's just really tremendous. And all this, if you just think about the long-term impact of this, so imagine our kids really getting that education and kids going through the system and actually graduating and getting some post-secondary education and getting good jobs. And to the extent that all that happens, what would be the impact on the pressure on law enforcement and on social services and on the health of our community and all these other things that we spend a lot of money on? So when people say supporting public education is an investment and not an expense, that's what we mean. Those things I just mentioned is really the return on the investment. So just something to think about as we go into these discussions in the coming weeks. Thank you.
Well, I'm sure we'll hear a lot about it.
I had one.
Pam and I have.
Bob, you're neglecting.
I'm sorry. I'm on. So we have a veteran military support group, right?
And the last time, I think we saw your video presentation. Very impressive.
Thank you. We were both sick. I apologize. We couldn't be here. Those of you who don't know me, I'm Tammy Crawford, Director of Veterans Services, and Alamance County Veterans Services has partnered with Pam Thompson. For those of you who don't know her, she is on the Alamance County Board of Education, and she's also the parent of an active duty military member. Now, we have formed the first local support group for parents, spouses, family members, and friends of active duty military. So we're here to thank you, the commissioners and Alamance County government, for supporting this group. We have a mission statement. Our mission statement is to increase public recognition of the value of our military and veterans and their families, their service and sacrifice, and raise public awareness of their contributions. So we want everybody, you guys, Alamance County, to get the word about our support group. We're very proud to start this along with Pam Thompson. And I want to give each one of you a flyer to put out.
Hello, Tammy's handing that out. I was fortunate to have my son his diploma June the 10th, and July 24th, he left. He left for Fort Jackson in South Carolina. And I had no idea as a mom what I would be experiencing. It is just, it's a form of grief. And so I knew, as over the top, fearless, and not scared of anything as I am, this really rocked me. And so I thought it was very important. I went through your government academy, which was absolutely amazing. And Tammy spoke at one of the meetings we had at the library. And I asked her, was there anything like that here? And I knew if I felt this way, there were some other parents and spouses as well. We've kind of really opened this up. And it's very important that we support those who are at home while our young men and women volunteer to go out. I also went to the Marines Educators Workshop. I was at Paris Island for 5 days. I had a drill sergeant, Sergeant King, also known as God Jr., that I met, and I will never forget her. I had her for 5 days and what she did to impress me, and it was really something to be around honor, integrity, and character, and that was it for 1 week. And I just a wannabe when it comes to the military. And they're very special, they're spectacular. And I met Marines, men and women that come there, volunteered, and what they put themselves through was absolutely amazing. So we cannot support this group enough, and we also want to really invest in our homeless vets and current vets, and we're having a hit it. I'll take over.
Okay. We're having a dinner to show appreciation on June 6th at 7 p.m. We do hold our meetings, our monthly meetings for our support group at Harvest Baptist Church.
Which is Bill and my church.
First Tuesday of every month. And on this particular night, it's going to be, our motto is Welcome Home Veterans. So it is going to be a free dinner. We need those veterans to RSVP because our numbers are limited. However, you know, we want as many to come as possible. So just please know that we have this wonderful group. We needed this for a very long time in Alamance County to support our active family members while their loved ones are serving. So very proud to be with Pam and be a part of this group.
Very thankful to our church. They didn't take a second chance. Anything they can do to help, it makes a big difference.
I'm going to mention one thing. Mr. Tillman, Colonel Tillman's already contacted me. They're going to have a special day July
the 7th.
7th at New Lambs Chapel for veterans
and
law enforcement, first responder
so
folks.
We will be speaking more about that. That's going to be a really big day here, too.
Yep.
Those of you that don't know Mr. Tillman, please come out and meet him.
He called me in the morning, afternoon. I mean, you can tell he's military because he was on me to call him back real quick.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks for coming.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. Any other?
Yeah, one more thing. I don't know how it got in there. I don't remember it being suggested, frankly. But, you know, today we had Tony. He had to leave, so we let him speak first rather than have to go last. And that's one thing. But, you know, what gets, I think could be a conflict and not maybe proper. You know, you could have citizens come here and have to sit 2 hours to speak about non-agenda items. You know, hour and a half, 2 hours, and when they can say their piece and leave. How'd that get in there to start with? Why'd we move it from the first to the last?
Felt like a lot of people were sitting here waiting for a meeting to get over, and a lot of folks are talking about non-agenda items, but I don't know.
Okay, we talked
about that in our discussion, I think Bob.
Okay, I missed the logic of that, though.
Because he said if we're going to do that at the end, let's do it before close comment, I think.
Well, the original suggestion was to have it all at the end.
And I thought if
somebody has something to say that we're going to vote on later, we ought to hear it before we vote on it. So I suggested that we put that.
By statute, really, public comments, I think it's once a month that we could.
Oh, sure, yeah.
But
it's just that, you know, and I think you're right. I know you're right. But I just wasn't listening. You know, I get burned out and don't hear everything. But, I thought the gist of moving something was because we wanted to do it before we went into closed session so somebody wouldn't sit here that long and then us come out.
Yeah.
But again, it just seems like if somebody comes up here and just wants to say, hey, let's say the Boy Scouts come up here.
Yeah.
And let's say, you know, they're not going to talk about an agenda item, but they want to talk about wherever they're going or whatever they're doing. To have to sit here 2 hours and go through a meeting just to get up and have their piece.
They show up, they got to lead the pledge. So.
Yeah. But that's my point. You know,
right.
You know, how do we feel about that? Should we make them sit here for 2 hours?
No,
or any other senior citizen or somebody who's has a health issue and they just want to come up and speak about a non-agenda item? I don't see why they can't. I don't know why we don't have a desire to facilitate an expediency of that issue.
Well, if I can say, Mr. Sutton, I really wish that you had raised your concern or discussed that when we were debating the matter, because I had reservations about that as well. I think I asked a question about to clarify what it is that we were talking about, and my reservation came from the idea that what if somebody says, yeah, I'm going to talk about an agenda item, and then they don't, and they get up and during the agenda item discussion, and then they get into it, is the chairman going to be put in a position to gavel somebody down, interrupt them, and so forth? And I just thought to truncate it, to make it shorter, have them all at the front would be more expedient, make it go faster. But when I kind of questioned about that, there wasn't any real other voices from the rest of the board, so I thought, well, it must be just me. So I wish that you would, if you would.
I've caught it now.
If you had spoken at the time, then
and we can look.
Well, I'm speaking now.
Okay, right. We can look.
And we can change it.
Yeah, we can.
All right, so I hope we'll consider.
It's a document that we've worked into, but we can adjust.
Sure.
I mean, it's a living document, as far as I see.
I don't have a strong opinion about.
I don't.
Having to divide it up, I'm.
I think I picked that up out of some other boards that had done that, just for expediency of the meeting moving on, but.
Well, I'll ask it.
We'll talk about it in the future if you want.
I'll ask for it to be put on the agenda for the next meeting, that we discuss amending our rules of procedure to just have all the public comments at the beginning of the meeting.
As we've done in the past.
Yeah.
Limited as we've done.
I think that's a good idea.
Okay. All right, very good. We'll take care of that. Good. Okay. Any other thing we need to talk about? Any dates?
Got it.
Meeting adjourned.
Sheriff, come around, we'll take that.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.